Hello. Good evening, everyone. Thanks very much for being here this evening. Is everyone ready to go? Perfect. I'm happy to share with Manitobans that MPI has reached a fair deal with workers. The mandate that we gave to MPI has allowed folks to come together at the negotiating table and settle the strike. Together, we were able to reach a deal just a few weeks after we were sworn in as government. This deal demonstrates our respect for workers at MPI, but also our commitment to responsible management of the public purse. It shows that we can value workers and that we can work towards balancing the budget within our first term. Here's what all MPI workers can expect. 3% in the first year, 3% in the second year, 2.9% in the third, 2.8% in the fourth year. Those are good wage increases for folks who deserve it. I especially want to thank the workers who spent weeks on the picket line, demonstrating for their right to a fair deal. I know so many families that have been affected by this strike. You've simply been asking for a government that would come to the table and negotiate fairly. You've asked for a government that would show workers respect. On election day, Manitobans gave us the mandate to do exactly that, to elect a new government that was done picking fights with workers. The previous government opted to pick fights and freeze wages for working people. With Brian Pallister and with Heather Stephenson, that was their approach. All it got us was labour strife, worse services, and ultimately, headaches for Manitobans. That doesn't work, and Manitobans are sick of it. They said that clearly and decisively on election day. Our government has come in with a mandate to end the headaches. A little over a week and a half after changing the board at MPI, we were able to put this PC strike behind us. We did this by sitting down with workers, respecting the bargaining process, and showing them that our government is a friend to the working people. And it will set us on a course, a path that will be respectful and responsible as a government for you, the people of Manitoba. Thank you. And I'm happy to take any questions either here in the room or over Zoom.
Minister, there's been a lot of people that have been waiting to make claims, that have been waiting to set those driver's license appointments. We still know there's claims that haven't been made from that big hailstorm. How long do you anticipate it's going to take for things to get kind of back to normal?
Well, and I'll just add workers who are eager to get back to delivering those services for Manitobans. So, yes, we want to see that happen as quickly as possible. I think some of those operational questions you're going to want to maybe address directly with MPI. What I can tell you is what I understand is, you know, this Friday is what they're working towards is a back-to-work day. What that means about when services will resume, certain services in certain areas, again, I think you'll have to check in with MPI. Our commitment is again, getting people back to work, but improving, not only getting people back the services that they deserve at MPI, but improving those services and making them better into the future.
What do you think this signals to Manitobans? This is kind of the first big deal that the new government has had an opportunity to kind of close since you guys have been in government. What should this say to Manitobans?
Well, it really sets the tone that we are ready to work with the working people of Manitoba to get fair deals, to make sure that they feel included in the future of Manitoba. It's been an antagonistic relationship between the previous government and workers. We want to tell workers now that we're willing to sit down with them, make sure that they get fair wages. But ultimately, what we're trying to do here is change the culture and empower workers to be a part of the larger project here in Manitoba of restoring the services and ensuring that people are getting the service that they need.
Do you see this deal as setting a precedent for other public sector workers in Manitoba?
No, I mean, I do think that the workers going forward are going to be, in various forms, are going to be at the negotiating table. I think what this sends, the message that it sends, is that we're willing to, as I said, put in the hard work to ensure that we're listening to those workers about the demands that they have or the stresses that they have and how we can better, you know, meet those. But no, I mean, I don't think that this deal, I think this is a specific deal with MPI that I think was job number one for us, and we wanted to get this done. We're happy that we're moving on from it, but I don't think that necessarily means anything is determined in terms of future deals with other circumstances.
What do you say to both the MPI workers and Manitobans that were really frustrated with how long it took to get to this point?
Yeah. Well, we certainly heard that frustration on the picket lines, through many months now, or I guess a couple months, where workers were out on the picket line, and we heard it very loud and clear that they were upset that there wasn't a posture from government, a directive from government that they should get this strike resolved. And ultimately, what ended up happening was we were in the middle of an election campaign, and we weren't getting there wasn't any kind of bargaining that was happening at the table that was constructive. And ultimately, you had a government that just said, final offer and walked away. That was the previous government's approach, right? And so that's, I think, why some of the frustration we saw from workers, and rightfully so, that they were not being respected by the previous government. I'm very happy about, moving very quickly to a resolution as soon as we were sworn in, replacing the MPI board, moving swiftly to get back to the table, and then staying at the table to make sure that the negotiations happened. They happened in a way that was responsible to the ratepayers of MPI, but also that stayed at the table and continued to work with those folks to make sure that we were getting a deal done.
Have you had any further conversations with that new board, any members of it, since putting them in place?
I have been in contact with the board chair. As I've said before, I have a lot of confidence in the new board that's been put in place at MPI. And, there is a lot of work that remains to be done at MPI. So obviously the strike was our first priority, ending the strike and, getting folks back to work. But now I think there's a lot of work that's going to need to be done to make sure that MPI is delivering the services and is, again, being responsible and, respectful of the ratepayers in Manitoba.
You said it. This was the first challenge to tackle. What is the next big challenge with MPI and that Crown Corporation that now you want to see them turn their focus to?
Yeah. There have been many challenges at MPI, and I think we're just scratching the surface about some of those, the impacts of some of those, of the challenges that we're seeing. I guess what I'll say is, I'm a new minister, and I appreciate that folks want to see action and movement on some of this, and I'm certainly going to work through that. But I think the first step was getting a board in place that can work through some of these challenges, and I'm committed to making sure that we work with them to, get some results to make sure that MPI is strong going forward.
Does this signal to you that you made the right choice in that board and those decisions that were made?
Yeah, we're very happy with the work that the board has done. Again, the directive that we gave was to get back to the bargaining table, but there was a lot of work that happened behind the scenes to make sure that, again, that this was being done in a responsible way, that we were, protecting the interests of the corporation while also giving workers a fair deal. So a lot that work obviously happened, at the directive of the board, and they were the ones sort of getting their hands dirty to get that done. I've got a lot of respect for the work that they've done to this point, but we also know that some of the specific skills that they have will be ideal for tackling some of the challenges that we already know about and ones I'm sure that we're going to learn about in the very near future about some of the challenges at MPI.
Are you prepared to tell us now what your next priority is for MPI?
Well, I think what I would like to do is I'd like to... as I said, get the strike behind us and spend some time learning from my officials, learning from MPI directly, and then working with the board to identify some of those priorities. I mean, I don't think we need to, think too far about some of the challenges that we've heard, whether it be with management, whether it be with Project Nova. There are certainly challenges at MPI, but ultimately what we want to do is we want to address those issues in a way that at all times puts the interests of ratepayers and the corporation, make sure that it's stable and that it's delivering the services that Manitobans count on. That's going to be our first priority.
I do understand we have some questions on Zoom.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
So we'll let Glenn Cassidy, our moderator, introduce.
Yeah, thank you very much. From Canadian Press, Steve Lambert. Go ahead. One question, one follow-up, Steve.
Oh, thanks. Hi, Mr. Wiebe. What do you estimate is the cost of this labor agreement over the 8% that was initially offered? And how is MPI going to pay through that, either through higher rates or through perhaps reducing net income to government?
I'm sorry, I didn't catch the last part of your last question there. If you could repeat it, Steve.
This will cost more money. Is that going to come from higher MPI rates or reduced net income to government?
In terms of the specific numbers, I think this is a question better posed to MPI. I think they have potentially can give you some of the numbers in terms of the impact on the corporation. The direction that we've given them is, as I said, to be smart about how we're getting this deal done, protecting ratepayers, protecting the overall health of MPI going forward. But we certainly haven't, we haven't given them a directive about specific rate increases. We know that the MPI obviously has to go before the Public Utilities Board. We respect the work that happens at the Public Utilities Board. And so I'm eager to, continue to work with them through that process. But ultimately, the directive from us is clear that we want to make sure that ratepayers aren't impacted, certainly not this year, but going forward, that is going to be a really important piece of the direction that we give to MPI.
Thanks. And 70% of any government's spending, roughly, is wages and benefits. If you're signaling to labor that you're a more labor-friendly government, you believe that workers deserve more, how do you intend to pay for this while apparently moving towards a balanced budget?
Yeah, I mean, we are setting a new posture, right, in terms of how we're dealing with labor. And what we've demonstrated here is that we can set that new posture. We can remain, in this case, at the bargaining table. I guess, again, the difference between what we did, we bargained hard at the table. MPI was, clear in their priorities. But at the same time, they stayed there. They worked through it and they showed workers that we respect them. That's going to be, I think, key going forward is that we want to make sure that we remain open to workers. We continue to work with them and listen to them and make sure that they're being fairly compensated. But ultimately, we have a mandate to balance the budget in the first term, and that's what we're committed to.
So sorry to interrupt again, but I'm trying to get an answer to this question. How will this increase be paid for?
Well, as I said, what ultimately the corporation will go to the Public Utilities Board, and we respect the work of the Public Utilities Board. In terms of the actual numbers, I think, you're going to have to talk to MPI. But I think it's clear that we do need to find a path forward that, doesn't impact the ratepayers. That's going to be our number. That's going to be a major concern for us.
All right. Thanks, Steve. We'll now return to reporters in room 68. Thank you.
Now that the strike is over, do you have any sense of how long Manitobans are going to be feeling the impact of it in terms of backlogs with MPI services? And Brittany made reference earlier to some of the claims that have been backed up. Do you have any idea how long we'll be feeling the impact of the strike?
Yeah, I think there will be certainly a backlog that needs to be worked through. Again, the board is very clear-eyed about the work that's ahead of them in terms of making sure that the corporation is meeting those standards to get the work back, the services back to Manitobans. That's certainly going to be a challenge. But first step was getting people back at work, and preparations have already begun at the corporation, I know. And again, you can talk to them if you need more detail on that. But work has begun about making sure we work through the backlogs as quickly as possible and prioritize areas that will have the biggest impact on Manitobans.
Any more questions? Good?
Okay. Awesome. Feels a bit weird coming this late at night, right? But I thank you very much for sticking around for me. This is appreciated.